Motivführung. Zu diesem Thema fand im September 1995 ein dreitägiges Seminar des Schiller-Instituts im slowakischen Schloss Dolna Krupa, ehemals im Besitz der Familie von Brunswick, statt. Professor Norbert Brainin, der Primarius des legendären Amadeus-Quartetts, erläuterte die Kompositionsmethode der späten Streichquartette Ludwig van Beethovens. Mit dem Auer Quartett aus Budapest demonstrierte er das Streichquartett Opus 127 in S-Dur.
We are going to try and show how the motivic development, how it works and what it does. I said yesterday in a similar session that there are actually Opus 127, 130, 132, and 133 who have very similar motives. But I must add that Opus 127 is somewhat different, as some of the motives create other motives. And this again, and this is something which is unlike, I would say, unlike 130, 132, or 133. Nevertheless, we shall try and show this. Let us see how we get on. All right, now, will you please start? I will interrupt you. Don't think you're going to play right through this piece now. I'm afraid not. Please note the opening bars with the chords in E flat and turn, palm, pa, the fourth is a very significant motif. Turn, palm, also palm, pa is very significant. Turn, pa, also ten, ta is also very significant. And then come down, ti, pa, ti, da, di, da, di, da, di, da, di, da, di, da. This is very, becomes very important now when you have the allegro proper, where you have ta, hi, ta, hi, da. This is ta, hi, ta, hi, tom, pi, tom, pa, tom, pa, tom, pa. You have the fourth sometimes can be down a fourth or up a fourth, or it can be down a fifth. It means it's a kind of in the reverse. It's the motif in the reverse, back or forth, that is. That can be done and is being done And while we have will you play this passage, please, for me? This. Play this for me, please. You see, this passage is in preparation for many similar ones later. In fact, they introduce certain scales. Now, if you wonder where it comes from, this is where it comes from. Also, when you have this is already an alliteration. So we'll have this again, and you carry on. And you see, all out of this is in contrary motion to is in contrary motion. This is very important that we notice these things for the observation. Please, once more. This element which has just been introduced, so it's being taken up independently. Please play on. Now, it is not very difficult to follow the similarities of the material that creates this bridge passage here, what we just heard. And now this ram, pam, pam, pam. Now this becomes a very important element later on. Please carry on now. Let's play this last. Dum pa ra ta 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 dum pam pam pam. Pam pam pam. Yes, please, I want you to note that it is this perfect counterpoint which is being wrought by from elements of the motifs into new, quite independent parts which are being played together expressive singing. Please, could you do this again from Allegro, the last Allegro, and please listen to it from that point of view. Pam 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 pa ear, together with something new, with an arpeggio is being introduced here, da 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 da, which gains great significance in the next movement. This also, but the rhythm is still from. It is both in the rhythmic sense and the note sense, it is motivic development. Please note. Please play once more from this rum. Pam, pam, pam. At the end of this passage, you have pam, pi, am, pam, pi, ram, pa. This is all which is exactly taken from beginning. It's very easy to see this, but this gains very great importance in the next passage. I just wanted to prepare you for this. Please, once more, play two bars before maestoso, please. Thank you. thank you very much. Over all this motivic development business, I have forgotten to tell you that suddenly the recapitulation appears, which seems to be quite unimportant in this context, because the whole first movement seems to be an array of motifs destined for the next three movements, so to speak, as we shall see. All right, carry on. Note how this main theme of the second movement, as introduced by the first violin after two bars, is taken from these passages, from these long scale passages, but in a very slow tempo and in a different rhythm. We will see. Thank you for starting. Okay, go ahead. Variation. Carry on. I didn't want to interrupt you. I just wanted to announce it. No, that doesn't matter. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much. I was going to interrupt, but I thought they played so beautifully, I thought I'd let them play, because after all, the music is still more important than the Motivführung. I shall try and tell you about it in afterwards. Now, the points. It is very easy to follow the familiar note arrangements of the main of the main motifs in this, and also of the next, this dancing movement, drum, bum, ba, da, de, dim, ba, always, da, da, de, dim, da, de, dim, da, da, de, dim, ba, da, de, and down again. And the whole thing is a kind of dance movement, a dance, maybe a dance in the heavens, something like that. And the next is a adagio molto espressivo, which is also also very easy to follow from the motivic point of view. And it goes up from E flat, from a semitone up into E major, and it stays there in this E major until it comes back again in the next variation and takes on the old rhythm again, and there. In this arpeggio, which comes from the first movement, is being taken up by the cello and then by the first violin, in accompanying the main subject again in a different guise. Play a bit of this adagio once more, please. Pardon? No, this here, the E major part, please. A bit, I just want to demonstrate. Now play this now. Only here it goes down, it goes in a scale up and down, and in the next one, it goes in intervals. But it is the same. I did the same thing. I just wanted to show you this. And now please play the last bar before the tempo primo, play from here with this upbeat. Have you got it? Yeah?
Yes.
Now this is E major. Now. Yes. Now this dropping or going up a semitone is a very typical, a very personal device of Beethoven. He does this quite often to change the mood from one to another. He just goes up a semitone, then sometimes he modulates down, sometimes he just drops the whole thing a semitone, which is here to great effect, of course. Do it once more. The roles are now changed over. You hear this absolutely perfect counterpoint, which if you were told it was by Bach, you would believe it. It's absolutely perfect. And now this is a new development here for the next variation. which is quite, I don't think it has anything to do with motivic development. It's quite extraordinary. Do it once more and go on with it, please. Yes, just from da-da-di-di. Now this is where we were before, as we were before. We are now again in E flat, and we are not leaving this E flat now up to the end. And this is how the piece ends. Right. Thank you very much indeed. Now let us carry on now to the next movement. Now. Here again, you will recognize the motifs very easily. Or even the beginning, which is plum, pam, pam, pam. It's easily recognized as of things that happened before. Please play the next movement. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Beautiful. Now, the outstanding feature, if it wasn't the scherzo itself, is this middle part, which is much faster, of course, and it is in not in E major, but in E flat major, and it runs at a speed which is how shall I say, it is as fast as possible, but even faster. Right, and it is very easy to follow. It is another variant of the main subject. It's very easy to follow that part. So you see, I did not want to interrupt too much. So as you can see, the connection between all this, and once I point out to you what to look for, you can hear it very easily. And they played absolutely marvelously. So let us go on to the last movement. Now we have a new element in the last movement. It is a variant of da-di, ba-ta-di, ta-di, ta-da-di, ta-di, ta-da-di, which is both a fifth and a fourth, and a third, which is the opposite of a seventh, of a sixth. I mean, and this goes right through this movement, as you will see. Please, carry on. Thank you.
Bravo.
I would like to say something else with regard to this counterpoint, which I pointed out to you before. You see, Beethoven, when he writes these counterpoints, he makes lines, singing lines, out of the same material, which are completely different from one another, and each one has a so-called life of its own, a kind of Eigenleben. Sometimes, of course, he leaves it like this, but I show you something. Have you got the music of 95 here by any chance?
95.
No, it doesn't matter. I'll show you something. I want to... where is it? Yeah. Better still. Please. Can you play this? Finito. Yeah, and now, can I borrow your violin for a moment? Thank you. Now, I will show you. You see, the second movement of Opus 95 goes there. Beethoven has this together with the following. I play it to you. Play. Right, that's it. You hear this? This is in Beethoven's notebook. It is written as a counterpoint, together, like this. But he never used it like this. He took it apart, and he used one part to create the first part of the movement, and the middle part he used the other ta-di and made the middle part, and it sounds completely different, and yet there is this a kind of a similarity and togetherness in this. And you don't know where it comes from, but it was actually created together, like this. Do once more. Sorry, once more. And so forth. Now, and out of this, is created the whole middle part, and then it goes back to the beginning. Now, this, because each of these two lines has an Eigenleben of its own, played alone. And so forth. Then it goes on. Not here, no. Here something goes on. Another part comes in. But not where. It comes in like this, you see. Poetic license. And then the then the cello, and then in the end the first violin comes in with this. And but these are two separate parts, two separate sections of the piece, and yet they are together like a hand in the glove. I just wanted to point this out to you. Thank you very much. All right, I think the... Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for playing so beautifully. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.